We have seen and studied the history of computer development through mechanical and electronic computers. Through five generations of electronic computers, the modern personal computer has evolved in the form of a desktop or a laptop or a tablet. It has become the mainstay of computing power available to individual human beings. It is this computer which is most facilitating and empowering to each person, and hence this module is devoted to evolution of personal computers from its birth in fourth generation to modern desktop or laptop machine. This module will focus on evolution of different aspects of the personal computer, such as hardware and software, CPU and peripherals, operating systems and application software, etc. We will also study the impact of networking on personal computer usage. Before the introduction of microprocessor in the early 70s, computers were generally large, costly systems owned by large corporations, universities, government agencies, and similar-sized institutions. End users generally did not directly interact with the machine, but instead would prepare tasks for the computer on offline equipment such as card punches. A number of assignments for the computer would be gathered up and processed in batch mode. After the job has been completed, users could collect the results, in some cases which would take hours or days between submitting a job to the computing center and receiving the output. A more interactive form of computer use was developed by the middle of 1960s. In a time-sharing system, multiple computer terminals let many people share the use of one mainframe computer. This was common in business application, science, and engineering. Let us now examine the meaning of the term personal computer. By definition, a personal computer is one which is created for an individual user and is intended for interactive personal use. Creative Computing magazine defined the personal computer as a non-time-shared system containing sufficient processing power and storage capabilities to satisfy the needs of an individual user. The history of personal computer begins in 1977 with the introduction of microcomputers as a mass-market consumer electronic devices. After the development of the low-cost microprocessor, an individual could afford it like a consumer good. Early personal computers, generally called as microcomputers, were often sold in electronic kit form and in limited numbers. They were very poor in computing power and in facilities. They were mostly used by hobbyists and technicians. By 1979, over 500,000 microcomputers were sold, and the youth of the day had a new concept of the personal computer. The period during 1977 to 1979 saw introduction of large number of products which were more collection of hardware with little software support. The notable models which saw commercial success were Altair 8800 from MITS, Apple I and Apple II by Apple, PET PET by Commodore, TRS-80 by Radio Shack, BBC Micro from Acorn, which put together sold 500,000 units in 3 to 4 years. Early machines were very weak in software support. Some needed a user to manually enter machine code of a loader program, which then loaded main operating systems from a paper tape reader. Some models used basic language interpreter program as minimal software or operating system and cassette tape as magnetic storage. Many of them used a 12-inch CRT monitor as a display, while some used a black and white TV as display. Later on, as floppy disk drives were attached to these machines, disk-based operating system software came in use. It was called Control Program for Microprocessor, CPM, and was developed by Gary Kildall. CPM 80 was the first popular microcomputer operating system to be used by different hardware vendors. Many software packages were written for it, such as VisiCalc, WordStar, and DBase 2. IBM responded to the success of Apple II with IBM PC, released in August 1981. It was based on an open plugged card based architecture, which allowed third parties to develop cards for it. It used Intel 8088 CPU running at 4.77 MHz containing 29,000 transistors. The first model used an audio cassette for external storage, though there was a floppy disk option. The original PC design was followed up in 1983 as PC/XT, which was available with a 10 MB hard disk drive. While the architectural memory limit of 640 kilobytes was the same, the original PC design could only accommodate up to 64K bytes on the main board, which was later revised up to 256 kilobytes. The IBM PC typically came with PC-DOS, an operating system based on CPM 80. PC-DOS was developed by Bill Gates of Microsoft, who was already providing the ROM basic interpreter program for the PC. IBM sold it as PC-DOS, while Microsoft sold it separately as MS-DOS. Although the PC and XT included a version of the basic language in read-only memory, most were purchased with disk drives and ran with an operating system. Three options were available: PC-DOS, CPM86, and UCSD P system. Neither the P system nor CPM86 was a commercial success. Because MS-DOS was available as a separate product from Microsoft, some computer companies made computers which could run MS-DOS and its programs. These early machines were the first competitors of IBM PC. The first truly IBM PC compatible machines came from Compaq, although many others soon followed. Because the IBM PC was based on relatively standard integrated circuits and the basic card slot design was not patented, the key portion of that hardware was actually the BIOS software embedded in the read-only memory. This critical element got reverse engineered, and that opened the floodgates to the market for IBM PC imitators, which was dubbed as PC clones. When IBM had decided to enter the personal computer market to compete with Apple, it was the giant of the computer industry and was expected to dominate the PC scene. But because of these shortcuts that IBM took to enter the market quickly, they ended up releasing a product that was easily copied by other manufacturers using off-the-shelf non-proprietary parts. So in the long run, IBM's biggest role in the evolution of the personal computer was to establish the de facto standard for hardware architecture amongst a wide range of manufacturers. The software company Microsoft, which provided the operating system and utilities to all PCs across the board, whether authentic IBM machines or the IBM PC clones, emerged as the dominant force from this competition amongst the hardware vendors. In 1984, IBM introduced the IBM Personal Computer AT, more often called as PC-AT or AT, built around the Intel 80286 microprocessor. The chip was much faster and could address up to 16 megabytes of RAM, but only in a mode that largely broke compatibility with the earlier 8086 and 8088. In particular, the MS-DOS operating system was not able to take advantage of this capability. In 1983, Apple Computer introduced the first mass-marketed microcomputer with a graphic user interface called the Lisa. The Lisa ran on Motorola 68000 microprocessor and came equipped with 1 megabyte of RAM, a 12-inch black and white monitor, dual 5 and quarter inch floppy disk drives, and a 5 megabyte profile hard drive. The Lisa's slow operating system and high price, around $10,000, however, led to its commercial failure. Drawing upon its experience with the Lisa, Apple launched the Macintosh in 1984. The Macintosh was first successful mass market mouse-driven computer with a graphical user interface, or WIMP, windows, icons, menus, and pointers. Based on the Motorola 68000 microprocessor, the Macintosh included many of the Lisa's features at a price of $2,495. The Macintosh was initially introduced with 128 kilobytes of RAM, and later that year, a 512 kilobyte RAM model became available. To reduce costs compared to Lisa, the year younger Macintosh had a simplified motherboard design, no internal hard drive, and a single 3.5 inch floppy drive. Applications that came with the Macintosh included MacPaint, a bitmap graphic program, and MacWrite, which demonstrated what you see is what you get word processing. While not an immediate success upon its release, the Macintosh was a successful personal computer for years to come. This is particularly due to the introduction of desktop publishing in 1985 through Apple's partnership with Adobe. This partnership introduced the Laser Writer Printer and Aldus PageMaker software, now called as Adobe PageMaker software, to the two users in later years. In later years, a number of different models of Macintosh, including the Macintosh Plus and Macintosh 2, were released to a great degree of success. The entire Macintosh line of computers was IBM's major competition up until the early 1990s. Apple's competitors, Commodore 64 and Commodore 128 models, used GEOS operating system, which was the first OS with full utilization of graphical user interface, or GUI. It could be used with a mouse or a joystick as a pointing device and came with a suite of GUI applications. Commodore's later computer, the Amiga, ran a GUI operating system by default. The Amiga laid the blueprint for future development of personal computers with its groundbreaking graphics and sound capabilities. Byte magazine then called it the first multimedia computer, so far ahead of its time that almost nobody could fully articulate what it was all about. In 1985, the Atari ST, also based on Motorola 68000 microprocessor, was introduced with the first color GUI in the Atari TOS. It could be modified to emulate the Macintosh using the third-party Spectre GCR device in 1987. Acorn launched the Archimedes range of high-performance home computers in Europe and Australasia. Based around their own 32-bit ARM RISC processor, the systems initially shipped with a GUI OS called Arthur. In 1989, Arthur was superseded by a multitasking GUI-based operating system called RISC OS. By default, the mice used in these computers had three buttons. PC-compatible clones dominated the market in 1986. The 32-bit 80386 microprocessor was released, and first 80386-based PC-compatible computer was Compaq Despro 386. For the first time, clones led the personal computer evolution over IBM. IBM's response came nearly a year later with the initial release for the IBM Personal System /2 series of computers, which had a closed architecture and was a significant departure from the emerging standard PC. These models were largely unsuccessful, and the PC clone style machines outpaced sales of all other machines through the rest of the period. Toward the end of 1980s, PC XT clones began to take over the home computer market segment, earlier dominated by Commodore and Atari. These systems typically sold for just $999 via mail order rather than a traditional dealer network. This price was achieved by using the older 8 or 16-bit technology, such as 8088 CPU, instead of the 32 bits of the latest Intel CPU. These CPUs were usually made by a third party, such as Cyrix or AMD. Dell started out as one of these manufacturers under its original name, PC Limited. The decade of 1990s saw tremendous improvement in CPU power and speed. The personal computer remained more or less the same, but every year the processing power went up, the speed went up, the memory went up, and the cost of peripherals came down. In a quick succession, Intel developed and released 80486, followed by a variety of Pentium processors. All these CPUs had a new feature called cache or cache memory. It was a very small but very fast memory in which the most often used parts of the user program were copied from the main memory and then executed at a faster speed. The feature increased the processing speed to such an extent that later CPUs started having more than one level of cache memories. Intel discontinued the use of numbers after 80486 and started using names as Pentium, Pentium Pro, Pentium 2, Pentium 3, and Pentium 4 to release faster and bigger processors. The processing power of these were phenomenal and much beyond the needs of average user. These CPUs had 42 million transistors on them and ran at 3000 megahertz speed. The next massive change in architecture came when Intel started adding parallel processing capabilities in a single CPU. This was done by adding or doubling resources needed inside a CPU to execute instructions. For example, one ALU was replaced by two ALUs. The instructions were loaded from main memories into pipelines and queued up before these ALUs for execution, often simultaneously. This meant that for most of the time, there were two instructions under execution inside a CPU. Such CPUs are called superscalar architecture. These CPUs will naturally work at double the speed of the CPU, which had only one ALU. An improvement in the technology brought the multi-core processor. It is a single computing component with two or more independent actual central processing units called as cores, which read and execute program instructions simultaneously. The instructions are ordinary CPU instructions such as add, move, data, and branch. But the multiple cores can run multiple instructions at the same time, increasing overall speed due to parallel computing. Manufacturers typically integrate the cores onto a single integrated circuit die known as chip multiprocessor or CMP, or onto multiple dies in a single chip package. The number of cores per CPU initially used to be just one. Multi-core techniques created a dual-core processor such as AMD Phenom 2X2 and Intel Core Duo. A quad-core processor contains four cores such as AMD Phenom 2X4 Intel's i3, i5 and i7. This technology currently produces 8 or 10 cores in a single CPU. A multi-core CPU implements the multiprocessing technique in a single physical package. Multiprocessing means performing more than one operation simultaneously inside a single CPU. CPU designers couple many cores in a multi-core device tightly or loosely as per the need. For example, cores may or may not share memory, and they may implement message passing or shared memory methods for inter-core communication. Multi-core processors are widely used across many applications, including general purpose, embedded, network, digital signal processing, DSP, and graphics. The improvement in performance gained by the use of a multi-core processor depends very much on the software algorithms used and their implementation. The evolution of personal computer was most certainly influenced by galloping CPU performance. However, the contribution of peripherals and networking capabilities added a dimension to the change in users' work environment. The peripherals which were enhanced or newly added since 1977 were 1. Mouse and touch screen inputs, 2. Audio in and audio out, 3. High resolution, high speed LED and LCD displays, 4. High performance, high capacity, low cost memory devices. The users were offered a convenient touch screen not only to touch the buttons but to slide the finger across the screen to initiate a scroll command. The displays became crisp, clear and very bright with very high resolution to show movies with excellent effects. The advent of special audio circuits called codec converted a personal computer into a powerful music system. When added with high quality display, the computer became a substitute of a cinema theater. When added with suitable software, the same hardware becomes a powerful gaming console. The storage industry exploded in three ways. Use of new magnetics provided low-cost terabyte storage. Use of DVD and Blu-ray disc (BD) provided high-capacity and ultra-fast devices for archival storage. And lastly, flash memories created small size, high gigabyte capacity portable storage for pen drives and SD card. Put together, these four improvements completely changed the way an average user looked at the computer and uses it today. The last but not the least important technological evolution came up in the area of computer networks. It began modestly with the use of serial port or interface to connect keyboard, mouse, modem, and many such peripherals to the CPU. Slowly, it evolved into Ethernet for internet access. Wireless technologies offered anywhere connection using Wi-Fi standard. Ad hoc connections between two computers or devices became easy due to availability of Bluetooth technology. The modems got integrated on the main board and GSM or GPRS link was established by merely adding a SIM card. Networking ensured that the value of each personal computer or node, as it is called in a network, tremendously enhanced by many times. A man can do far more work when collaborating online at all times with other similar persons working on their computers. So much was the impact of internet on modern computer usage that the new technique called cloud computing puts the user's data on some other computer's hard disk and makes it available through internet anywhere and anytime. Last capability enhancement in personal computers came from image capture through cameras and scanners. Image processing software and image display on screen or printers. The personal computer also became a photo studio machine. Thus, a modern personal computer can certainly be used as a high-speed computer for data processing, but it is also used for enjoying audio, movies, and to work with images, all alone or through other users on internet.